Good evening, everybody, and welcome to a lovely Saturday evening with the Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj Vastu Sangrahalaya in Mumbai. Good evening, Anurupa. It's nice to have you. On the homepage of the International Union of Puppetry, of which our speaker today is a trustee, is a piece called Passing By, Listening, Resisting. It says, referring to the pandemic, never has communication been so important and blatant in the existence of art. So we thank Anurupa for helping us do just that today. And we're so happy so many of you are able to join us and listen in. We'll be taking questions to the end, so please type them out in the chat box and we'll address them later. Most of us are probably familiar with Anurupa's work, but I would like to introduce her formally. Anurupa Roy is a puppeteer, puppet theater director, and puppet designer. She's the founder and managing trustee of the Kathaka Puppet Arts Trust, a puppet theater group based in Delhi since 1998. She has a diploma in puppet theater from the Drama Institute of Film, Radio, Television, and Theater at the University of Stockholm, Sweden, and has been trained in traditional glove puppetry from the School of Traditional Glove Puppetry in Naples, Italy, under Bruno Leoni in 2002. She has been a researcher in residence 2011 at the Deutsche Forum of Puppet Theater and Puppetry in Bochum, Germany, and at the International Institute of Puppetry in France. She has been a pro Helvetia artist at the residence at Rote Fabrik in Zurich, Switzerland, and guest faculty at the World Arts and Cultures at UCLA in Los Angeles, California. She has directed performances at Kathita, the Theatre and Education Company National School of Drama, and the Jananatya Manch. She's a recipient of the Ustad Bismillah Khan Yuva Puraskar 2007 National Award granted by the Ministry of Culture, Government of India, for her contribution to puppet theatre. She's currently the trustee of UNIMA India, the Indian chapter of the Union Internationale de la Marionette, which is the International Union of Puppetry. I now welcome Anurupa to take it from here. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you. It's a real honor to be present this evening, and hello to everyone present. What I'm going to do is take you through a very short PPT. Is it possible to pin the PPT when I start sharing it? So let me start from the first. The lecture today is called Puppet Theatre Past and Present. And just to give you a background, this is a wonderful opportunity because rarely do I get the chance to talk to people who are outside the immediate puppetry community or the theatre community. And museums are fantastic spaces where puppet theatre is present both as the past and the present. And in puppet theatre, we feel the great need to acknowledge the past, because in India, puppet theatre is almost about 3,000 years old, and it is one of the oldest living traditional forms of puppetry, comes from India, this subcontinent. And so it has a very special place in the scheme of things in India and the subcontinent. So this particular lecture will focus on the past, which means on traditional forms, and also somewhat on the present, which is the contemporary puppet theatre forms, as well as what has happened to the collective post the pandemic and the lockdown. As all of you would know or have guessed that the arts are something which have really suffered through this lockdown, as have so many professions, but artists have not been able to practice their art form at all. And puppetry, which was a very marginalized art form to begin with, especially some forms of puppetry in India, has really taken a hit. We'll come to how and why. The first thing I'm going to throw at you are certain general terms of modern puppetry and traditional puppetry. These are generic terms and are very debatable terms. I'm using them in a very loose format with a disclaimer that these are debatable questions. So, in the talk today, I'm going to explore the form, the text, the context, and the history of puppet theater in India and the subcontinent, because never were the traditional art forms of India restricted to an India entity. They were always a part of the subcontinent, and it gives you a sense, understanding the subcontinent gives you a sense of how the arts evolve. They're not static. Tradition doesn't mean that something got stuck 1,000 years ago or 2,000 years ago or 3,000 years ago. It doesn't mean that anything is performed in the same way it was even 100 years ago. Tradition is constantly reinventing and changing. And the reason it survives through so many hundreds of years is because it's able to innovate and change. And then there is the modern movement, which in India comes definitely post-independence. And I'm going to talk a little bit about contemporary puppetry, mostly through the work of Katkatha Puppet Arts Trust, which is our company, which started in 1998. So I'm just going to the next part, is the important considerations. So this is something to keep in mind when we discuss traditional puppet theater. Dare I propose that this is true for a lot of all traditional forms, but I'm not an authority on the other forms, so I will stick to puppet theatre. And maybe some of you who are listening to this talk come from a dance background or a music background, and you might see some resonances with this, or an art and painting background. So the first and foremost, and this is very important to remember, that the narrative guides the form in traditional puppet theatre across South and Southeast Asia. The narrative comes first, the story comes first, the story becomes the root or the primary source. And on the basis of that, the puppets are designed. I am going to illustrate this in a few slides later. Also, the aesthetic of the form comes, and the narrative and the visual context comes from the regional context. Which part of the world are we talking about? Which part of India are we talking about? What is the predominant, let's say, cultural practice, or the various cultural practices, the layers of community and its existence in that particular part of the country? Added to that is the history of that part of the country. And all of this would inform things like narrative and hence aesthetics. The second part is, this is also extremely important. I found it fascinating when I started researching traditional puppet theater that my assumption always was that traditional puppet theaters, the narratives are based on the Ramayana and the Mahabharata and some stories of the Purans, and also from regional stories. Now, this is true, but what is very interesting to understand that each of the puppet traditions, and when I say each of the puppet traditions, we have 18 living traditional forms in India. And most people hearing this talk would know the Rajasthani Kathputlis, as do most people in India, because they're the most popular, they're the most visible, everybody's seen them. And also the community of the Rajasthani Kathputli Walas were traveling performers. They would go from place to place performing. Whereas the other forms are all region-based, geography-based, tied to certain cultural practices, rituals, tied to the temple or a community. Coming back to the narrative, it is true that most of the forms, not the Kathputlis, of course, of Rajasthan, and most of the forms are based on mythological narratives, but this is very interesting, that all of them are oral narratives, except for the Kamba Ramayan, probably in Kerala, which is performed as Tolpavakuthu, the traditional shadow puppet form. Nothing was ever written down. It was only passed orally as a narrative. And what does that mean? It means that it goes from family elders or community elders to younger people in the community. And they don't learn in a classroom. They don't even learn in a gurukul. They learn by watching the elders, by being backstage during the show, by imbibing all these narratives almost through osmosis. And when I say this, it doesn't mean that there are loose narratives. There are verses. There are there's poetry, there's prose, things that need to be memorized by the performers. Also, very importantly, the narratives themselves vary hugely. So I've written a little note here. that there is the Ramayana is one story with 100 renditions. When I say one story, which means one key thread running through the Ramayana, you know that there is an exiled prince. He ends up in the forest. There is an encounter with the king of, in some cases it's the demons, in some cases it's another kingdom, and there is a fight. And on his side are the monkeys and bears, and on the side of the other king are these very powerful forces. Now, this is the common narrative. However, from one story of the Ramayana to another in the regions of India, all the other specs can change. For example, in some versions, Ram and Sita are brother and sister, they're not husband and wife. In some versions, the hero is Hanuman and not Ram. In some versions, the hero is Ravan and not Ram. In some versions, Ravan actually picks a fight with Ram because it's another birth in which he and his brother, which is him and Kumbhakarna, will be reborn 6 times. And in order to get released, they have to be killed by the avatar, have to be released by the avatar. So there are so many narrative versions. Whereas in the Mahabharata, there are many perspectives. You have the Mahabharata of Hadimba in Himachal. You have the Mahabharata of Shakuni. You have the Mahabharata of Duryodhan. You have the Mahabharata of Draupadi, which you can hear among the Panduani singers. So the versions change, the perspective change in the Ramayana, the versions change. Now we come to the very important thing of the role of the puppeteer. Our modern understanding of a performer is someone who gets up on stage and entertains you for a certain period of time, maybe asks questions, maybe poses questions, makes us reflect about society, about internal dilemmas and social, political concerns. And these are something the actor does. But you also go to the theater so the theater space, especially in much more of an urban setting or a semi-urban setting, is a contract where we're watching a play, we want to be entertained, we want to have fun, we want to go home with memories, we want to see beautiful visuals, we want to be awed. So in the village, it's slightly different. Or I would say in traditional generational forms, it's slightly different. Because there, of course, all of this also holds true. People do come for entertainment. They do come in to be bowled over by visuals and the rendition of a song or the intensity of a dialogue. But very often, the puppeteer is also a scholar. For example, in Kerala, again, the Puluvar community, which does puppet theater, the title Puluvar means a scholar. It comes from a scholarly background. It's a bestowed title, which means this is a person who knows all the texts. This is also the wise one. Very often, they're shamans. In Malaysia, they are exorcists. So shadow puppeteer, after his shadow puppet performance, will take away bad energy. In Orissa also, they take away bad energy from the land. In Tamil Nadu, they invite rain. Sometimes their advisors in Karnataka, very close traditional puppeteer friend of mine, he also works as a matchmaker. He tells us stories of, you know, this is pre-WhatsApp and all these wonderful quick click applications. He would take letters from boyfriend to girlfriend, from lovers, from one village to another. They're also problem solvers. Communities go to the puppeteer because this is the wise person for solutions. Very often during elections, for example, local elections, they'll ask the puppeteer, who's very popular, who's very well known, to come and do a performance. So much so in Indonesia, when the most famous puppeteers, the puppeteers like Anum Suharto, who is like an equivalent of a Shah Rukh Khan in Indonesian society, during elections, if he throws his weight behind one of the candidates, what he would do is in a show, instead of Arjun, replace the puppet with a cutout of, let's say, the prime ministerial candidate, then all the votes would go to him. And so this is a very influential, very powerful, very wealthy artist. And I'm clearly born in the wrong country, but that apart. Then also there is the obvious thing of being the entertainer and the publicist. So If you look at the Kathputliwalas, they're very interesting. The Bhat community was, the puppeteers of the Kathputliwalas were given money and support by the king of Nagaur, Amar Singh Rathod. And it's his story that they narrate. And Amar Singh Rathod is gone, but for 700 years, his story has lived on. So they become then the advertisers and the publicists. The last and very important aspect of the puppet theater is the audience. And there is the unique relationship in the traditional format. So in traditional society, the audience already knows the story. The audience has been watching the story for as long as it has lived. Very often, and I've sat through shows with traditional puppeteers, an audience member comes to the back and would be very angry, an old man who would say, "You didn't tell that joke. Your father used to tell the joke like this, and I always laughed at this joke. You skipped that joke." So there is, you know, the very high expectation of the traditional narrative. But there's also a philosophical connection that any puppeteer has with his or her audience, is that the puppet is actually dead material. The puppet doesn't live. And even if I am the most fantastic puppeteer in the world, if I were, I still cannot bring the puppet to life. So the puppet lives only in the head of the audience. And that is the most unique aspect of the puppet theater, that the livingness of the puppet happens only because there is the watcher, the witness, or the audience. So I'm going to the next slide. If you have any questions, just keep your questions ready. I will take them at the end of the talk. I talked about how narrative guides the form. And I'm going to be very quick because I know it's not a very long talk. So this will give you an idea. The two characters are the two Hanumans. It's Hanuman, but they look different. Now, how do they look different? Is the first Hanuman, if you see, is green in color. Green or blue were often the color of divinity in the puppet theater. Remember traditional puppetry, the colors were red, black, white. Red was created out of certain berries mixed with folic acid from the bodies of ants. Black was created with soot from a lamp. And white is the leather, it's the virgin leather color. Greens are sometimes plant pigments, and blue would come from lapis lazuli. So it was extremely precious material. Green is also very difficult to make, so it is used very frugally. If you look at this puppet, Hanuman here is, why is it that there are two Hanumans in the same show? Actually, there are seven Hanumans in the same show. This Hanuman is the one who is in Shantam. He's a divine creature. His rasa is Shantam of peaceful. The next Hanuman, if you see, both of them have teeth, huh? So they're both in their warrior mode. But in the second one, he's already got the gada, but on his body are lots of flowers. What is the significance of the flower? That he's just come out of prayer, going into war. This is a particular prayer for fighting, or just a pre-war prayer. You see it reflected across his body. You see it in the design of the puppeteer. This is how the puppeteer lets you know the state of mind that Hanuman is. So this is what I mean when I say the narrative guides the form. So in the narrative, this is the point just before the war. The two armies are preparing to go into the war, and Hanuman is leading the monkeys, or this could be a moment when he's ready to go off to deliver Ram's message to Sita in Lanka. So this is a very particular moment. And the other one, the Shantam, is Hanuman not during war. Here, this is what I mean by the 300 Ramayans. If you look at the two Ravans here, look at how different they are. It's two completely different aesthetic forms. On the left, we have Ravan Chaya from Orissa. On the right, we have Togalu Gombayata from Karnataka. Both are leather shadow forms. The first one has no color. The second one has color, and all the Ravans are facing front except for one who faces sideways. The two stories are very different. In the Ravan Chaya story, the primary version is that Ravan has a Chaya, Ram doesn't, because he's divine. And when there is any sort of a drought on the land, you have the image, you have demons who have taken over the land. When Ravan comes in and his chaya or his shadow falls on the land, the demons run away because he's the king of demons. And in the end, it's Ram who kills him. So all of the energies are purified. Togalu Gombayata is quite different. Togalu Gombayata, Ravan is not just a demon. He is also a Shiva Bhakt, a follower of Shiva. He is also an extremely knowledgeable man. He's a scholar. And in the Togalu Gombayata, and this is something which I find fascinating, there's not one Ravan, but six Ravans. This is Dashakantha Ravan or the 10-headed Ravan. There is the 100-headed Ravan or the Shatakantha Ravan. There is Maya Ravan, where there is no Ravan, but it is a hologram. There is Chaya Ravan, which is very closely linked to the story of how the puppeteers come to being. There is Mahiravan and Ahiravan, the two brothers who are the lords of the underworld. So there's six Ravans in this form, and there's only one Ravan in Ravan Chaya. I can see questions are coming in already. I'm going to take them eventually. Now let's go to the visible puppeteer, because I was talking about the role of the puppeteer. So just to illustrate what the role of the puppeteer is, both as a performer and as a non-performative role. If you see on the left, this is Pava Kathakali, the doll, or Pava is doll, Kathakali from Kerala. Now there's one group in Trichur, but there were many traditional puppeteers who would perform the Bhadrakali show, the story of Bhadrakali. But this particular group does performances from the Mahabharata. If you see, the puppeteer is fully revealed and also does all the facial expressions of a Kathakali dancer. So he is the added expression of the puppet. On the right, if you see the glove puppets, you see Modun and Putti. Modon and Putti come from Beni Pudul glove puppet tradition of West Bengal. The person you see in the middle is Ganesh Khurai. He is a wonderful glove puppeteer from West Bengal. He sings all the songs, but in this particular scene, which is why I picked this up, he's also a co-actor because he tells the audience that Modon and Putti are getting married. Putti, the girl, she has no relatives. She's an orphan. Then he invites someone from the audience to become her mama. Then he invites someone to become Modon's chacha or uncle. And then Putti is given away by the uncle. Then he asks the uncle for 500 rupees. Then he asks the other uncle for 100 rupees. This is for the banquet. He slowly starts to involve the audience. So these are the puppeteer's role is not that of being hidden behind a screen. That's a much more 20th century modern puppetry phenomena than this very traditional role where the puppeteer was visible, having conversations with the audience, introducing modern politics, making a comment about something or the other in society. So his role was very varied. Let's come to where did it all begin and the history. Where did puppetry originate? There's a big debate in the puppetry community among scholars about whether it started in India or started in China. My answer to this always is that I really don't care. I'm really happy there's puppet theater in this world because I'm a puppeteer. The second is, you know, this question of theories about the beginning in India. We have linguistic proof from several texts of how puppet theater traveled, not so much of, you know, where did the first puppeteer come about, which was the first puppet. Conjectures, and one of the conjectures that I find logical, so I would share with you. And again, my disclaimer is there is no concrete proof, but since human beings were hunters and gatherers, and they were hunting animals, and the residue of hunting was always skin, hide, and leather, and bones. And if you see in Indonesia, for example, the leather shadow puppets, the sticks are made with bone. It's possible that the first form of puppetry was probably leather shadow puppets. And also, remember that these are performances done in the night, and the source of light in shadow puppetry is very important. And this source of light was always fire, even till recently. Till the electric bulb replaced the fire. So it can be imagined that when human beings began to tell stories, they were not just telling stories sitting down, verbally narrating. They probably had props. They probably used the firelight to cast shadows on the wall of the cave behind them and told these spectacular stories of the hunt. So it's possible that the first form of puppetry was shadow puppetry. In India, the origin of shadow puppets is definitely what is present day Maharashtra. In Pinguli district today, we have a very few practitioners. And when I say practitioners, they have retained only small parts of the show. They're called Chamra Chie Bahulie. Chamra is leather and Bahulie is doll. So Chamra Chie Bahulie is the origin of leather shadow puppetry in India. These puppeteers then travel along the southern coast. So if you meet the puppeteers of Karnataka and Andhra, they're all actually Marathi. They all speak Aade, which is the root Marathi language. So linguistically, we can see how puppets journeyed. And then they went somehow to Tamil Nadu and came to Kerala from Tamil Nadu. 1,000 years ago, the Maharaja of Palakkad, invites the puppeteers to come and tell the Kamba Ramayan in the Bhadrakali temple. So even today, if you go to Palakkad district, across the district, there are 89 temples which have their own puppet theatres. And in the during the Bhadrakali festival, which is in which starts from March and goes on till May, as we speak, every year, the performance of 11 nights, 21 nights, up to 64 nights of the Ramayan, only the Ramayan, is done in the temple and is done for the goddess. It's not done for an audience. An audience also happens to be there. South and Southeast Asia. Now, this is my favorite story because in South and Southeast Asia, there was an interchange. So from Orissa, puppets went to Thailand. From Thailand, arts, culture, sculpture, everything was traveling, came back to India. And we know of these stories. We know, for example, the princess of Ayodhya who marries the prince of Puria, princesses from Kerala marrying princes of Sri Lanka and vice versa. So intermarriages between Siam, which is Thailand, Myanmar, India, we are talking about present day geography. I'm going to share a map with you and you'll see how different the maps were and how this kind of travel was possible. So my favorite story is that of the dowries and the trousseaus of princesses took performing artists with them. And puppeteers and musicians often traveled with them. So shadow puppets can easily be piled up. They don't need much space. And there is a theory that both trading ships, because ship travel was very, very long, and trousseaus of princesses were carried on these ships with the performers carrying these leather shadow puppets. And in the night, if the sea was calm, they would actually perform and project on the sails of the ship, because that was fabric as well. Similar stories are the Arabian Night stories, because they have traveled the entire subcontinent along the trade routes. Here are some of the maps, 1st century AD. If you look carefully, there is the kingdom of Kalinga, and there is, which is Orissa today, is partly Orissa. A lot of intermarriages happened between the kingdom of Kalinga and Siam, both the Malay states, the Khmer states, what is present day Siam and Bali. Let's look at 100 AD, for example, and you see the Chola Empire. Now we know that in Chola, from the Chola Empire and the Chera Empire, there were ships traveling out to Southeast Asia and ships traveling back, carrying various goods, people, and puppet theater was definitely traveling during this time because you see the Ramayan, which originated in India at some time between these expeditions, during these expeditions, traveling to Bali, to Thailand, where you have the Ramakien, you have the Khmer Ramayan, and all of these areas have their own versions of the Ramayan today, and the puppet performance forms. This is pre-partition India. And the reason I'm showing you this is very important in the politics of puppetry, in the evolution of puppetry. So you see the state of Mysore and also the Madras presidency. The state of Mysore is a kingly state and the Madras presidency is a British region. And something very interesting that happens, and I'll share that image right at the end with you, is in the late 1800s, I think this is about 1886, if I'm not mistaken, the sedition law is passed by the British. And this sedition law is used against the puppeteers because the British actually intercept some puppet theater companies taking anti-British propaganda messages from one village to another. And they ban the puppet theater form. Now, the puppet theater form was extremely important in many of the states ritualistically and continue to be today. Like I said, in Kerala, also in Karnataka, every rite of passage, birth, death, marriage, has to be completed with a puppet performance. You know, so there was great panic among the people because they wanted their shadow puppet shows. So the Maharaja of Mysore actually sends an emissary. He had very good links with the British Empire through the tutor of his son. And they make a request to reinstate the shadow puppet form. However, the British agree on condition that the British must be shown in very good light during the performance. So certain puppets are built. These are new puppets, and I'll show you the slide right at the end. So these are British characters in red coats, and they travel, they are shown passing on the screen. And they're also horse riders. So it is passed by the Subedar, and he says, okay, good. And that is that, except when you see the performance, the horses are not horses, they are donkeys. So the audience basically has a great laugh about this, and it becomes a form of protest that the puppeteers indulge in. Now, I'm going to go run very quickly because I think I have to be a bit fast. I would really like to show you some videos. So this is just to share with you what I'm showing on the video. We classify puppets in four very, very basic classifications. Now there are many, many subtypes, but shadow puppets, flat puppets, which are projected onto a screen, glove puppets, that which you wear in your hand, rod puppets, which you hold with a stick, string puppets, which are, you know, held with threads, like the Rajasthani Kathputli. Shadow, like I've said, is the oldest form. Leather is the primary material. And we've talked about Maharashtra being the original shadow puppet form. Tamil Nadu has its own form, Tholu Bommalatta. Tholu Bommalatta in Andhra Pradesh, Tholu Pavakuthu in Kerala, and Togalu Gombayatta in Karnataka, and Ravan Chaya in Orissa. To just show you how shadow puppets, the type of shadow puppets, this is from the Togalu Gombayatta tradition. If you see on the left, the puppet looks like a painting. It's a multiple image. The image is, actually this particular image is of the Palace of Illusions, Indraprastha, that the Pandavas had built. When this is called a jamgat is a composite image. It could be the entire scene of the game of dice. Is a jamgat scene. You have Yudhishthir, you have Shakuni, you have the game of dice, you have Shakuni's dead father's skeleton like at the, lying at the back, you have the gods watching from the top and the demons watching from below. Ikpat is a single image. So in the single image, the puppet is not articulated. The hands and the feet don't move, but you can see Ravan on his chariot. So it's a full, complete image. This is a Hathparuthali. A lot of puppets are Hathparuthali, which means where hand, feet, and everything is articulated. It's moved. Shadow puppetry. I've already talked to you about. I'm going to show you a video, which I'll show you all together. Glove puppets. Glove puppets in Kerala, I told you, Pavakathakali, you've seen this image before. In Uttar Pradesh, they're called Gulabo and Sitabo. They're two puppets where they fight with each other. They're very funny. They make a lot of commentary on society. In Orissa, it's called Sakhi Kundai, and in West Bengal, it's called Beni Potole. I have with me here one of my glove puppets. This is a Commedia dell'arte puppet. So all glove puppets have clown characters, and they are comedians. They make a lot of commentary on society. They are burlesque. They make terrible jokes. They burp and fart and do terrible things. My character is called Pulcinella. Pulcinella is not quite used to the Zoom format. Woohoo! Hey, Pulcinella, you're covering me. Yeah. I better get him out before he takes over the talk. and this becomes a show. So traditional rod puppets. Rod puppets primarily exist in West Bengal, where the puppet, and these are really big puppets, and they perform like the jatras are performed, and in Orissa. So Danger Putul in West Bengal and Kathi Kundai in Orissa. In Karnataka, there's a fusion form where the puppeteer, again, you'll see it in the video, the puppeteer wears a ring around his head, and there are strings emanating from the head, and holds rods in the hand. It's called Salakhi Gombayata. And a very unique form of puppetry is called Nokku Vidya. It's in Kerala, and it's only played by women. And they wear, they hold a stick just above their lip, and they manipulate the puppets, holding the puppets here. They're more like trick puppets rather than long elaborate stories. Lastly, traditional string puppets. There are many, many, many forms. I mean, I'm going to rattle off some names, but it's absolutely unnecessary to remember names. But this is just so that some of you, if you are from the region and you're familiar, maybe you can identify with them. Rajasthani Kathputli, as all of you know, and I told you about the Amar Singh Rathore story. They do the Singhasan Battisi story. They do they do the Dhola Maru story. In Assam, there's Putul Nach, string puppets of Assam. And again, if you see the puppets of Assam, West Bengal, they look a lot like the local temple idols. And very often you'll find that the puppet maker, especially the maker of the face, is the same. West Bengal, we have Tare Putul. Tare Putul is quite fascinating. One of our colleagues, Sudeep Gupta from West Bengal, is currently researching Tare Putul, and they're all performed out of circus tents. So big groups of puppeteers in trucks travel from village to village. They set up this huge tent. They carry their own carpenters, their own cook. They have their own orchestra, their own puppeteers. They perform the shows. Each day is a different performance. They stay in a village for 1 month, and there are 30 shows in the repertoire. And shows are repeated 3 times. So you have the morning matinee, afternoon, and the evening show. And they will play it every day for 30 days. People will come and watch the show. A lot of people keep time aside so that they watch 10 or 20 or 15 shows. And then while this one town has the performance, another set, the tent, etc., is being set up in another town so that they can wrap up here and immediately start performing in the next town. It's quite like the circus. It's quite spectacular. And unfortunately, very few of this particular form are left. Orissa Gopalela also does only the Krishna story and the stories from the Krishna Leela. It came about after the Vaishnav movement becomes popular in the east of India. In Karnataka, we have the Yakshagana Gombayata. Yakshagana, as you know, is a dance form, theater dance form of Karnataka. The Yakshagana Gombayata is the puppet version of it. Again, you'll see it in the video. And Sutra the Gombayata, as I said, with the rings on the head. And there is Kalsutri Bahulya, string puppeteers of Maharashtra. Now, they're found in Pingali district. And since some of you might be from Maharashtra, if you ever want to take a trip to Goa, stop by at Pingali, not far from Goa. There is now a beautiful museum space where you can see the puppets on display. It's run by one of the traditional puppeteers. You can also watch a performance. And Tamil Nadu has Sutra the Gombayata. I'm going to come to the last part of this so that I can move to the videos. Puppet theater is a very, the community of puppeteers is very complex. Puppet theater has created for centuries a certain caste mobility because it does not follow strict rules of this caste. Remember, puppeteers were often lower caste, they were working with leather. And this relegated them to a lower caste. But because they were puppeteers, because they were carriers of the oral narrative and heritage, they had access to the temple. And they were invited to perform in the temple. Sometimes not inside, just outside. But it gave them that in-between space of negotiation. This is across the south, this is seen. There is also a very strong story of usurpation within puppet theater, because many have come from outside and usurped. This is people from cities, this is also upper castes, took the form, changed the message, and the more marginalized the puppeteer, the more vibrant the performance, the more jokes and satire and humor is embedded into the show. As it got more classical, they lost the clown, for example, made it much more prim, much more censored. This has not happened to every form, but this has happened to certain forms. Traditional patronage was always the village head, the king, the local, you know, powerful person locally. Whereas today it's the nation state, it's the state agencies, the state bodies, the song and drama divisions, the cultural centers, the ministries of culture, etc. This patronage has also meant something. It has meant, because patronage is long distance, because the patron today is not located in the region, patronage is often without mindfulness to what the puppeteer really wants to do and what is the role of the puppeteer in society. Lastly, we've already talked about humor, and I would like to talk about the Vidushaka, because in the puppet theater form, the Vidushaka, the clown, is very important, because that's a social contract the puppeteer had with the community, especially the powers that be within the community, that the puppeteer had the permission, or rather the puppet had the permission to say and do anything he or she wanted. This is the puppet of resistance that I wanted to show you. You see the British officer on the ass, on the donkey, and the two British officials in front. This was passed by the Subedar, who thought it was a bad drawing of a horse, but actually it was a donkey made on purpose. I will end with that, this particular segment. Thank you. I move to some videos for you now, because I think I've talked enough. Might be fun to watch something. This is a video of the traditional puppet shows of from a festival in 2003 in Sangeet Natak Academy. It's now in the public domain.
তুমি সব ভুলে যাও আর আমি কত রকম খেলা করে যাই আমরা তো মেয়ে, মেয়েরা তো অনেক শিক্ষা দীক্ষায় কম, যেটুকু সুযোগ এতদিন আদায় করেছি আজ তারা বিপদের মুখে। বিপদ কিসের বিপদ? দেখ রে ভোলা, দেখ রে ভোলা, দুনিয়াটাকে দেখ রে ভোলা,
തമയാ മുന്നാദി കാലത്ത് വിശ്വാമിത്ര മഹർഷിയാനവരുടെ യാഗനഷ്ടാട്ടം പോകും കാലത്ത് ஒன்று கூடியால் பிடித்து பார்வை செய்து
கொள்கிறேன்.
போய் பிடிக்கலாம் என்று உத்தேசம் நிற்கும் காலத்து
That was
I'm sorry, I really forwarded through that with little clips of poems that I mentioned, just to give you a sense of what the poems look like. In terms of modern puppetry, and I'm afraid we're really out of time, so I'm going to quickly tell you a little bit. The modern puppetry movement started sometimes in the early 60s, actually, with Meher Contractor in Ahmedabad. And also simultaneously, there were puppeteers in West Bengal like Suresh Datta, Hiren Bhattacharya. They were very deeply influenced by the Obrazov style, which is the Russian puppet master from the Moscow Puppet Theater. And Meher Contractor was influenced by several international traditions, but also took a lot from the traditional, was very deeply inspired by Tolu Bommalatam and the leather shadow puppet forms, except all her plays were modern stories, like Rustam and Sharab is something she did. She did a lot of work for school teachers. So the early modern puppet theater was part of classroom teaching and a part of arts and education programs. And then the movement with performances and arts began quite a bit with Suresh Datta, who did his very famous Ali Baba, his very famous The Banvas of Sita, Love Kosh, and many more modern performances. Hiren Bhattacharya had this beautiful orchestra of musicians. Then in Delhi, there was Dadi Padamji, who in the early 1980s started the Sriram Center Basement Puppet Theater and did extremely modern and experimental work, where shoes were puppets and umbrellas were puppets. And these were, he also trained in Europe, and there was a strong influence. I fall into a generation after that. And now there is a younger generation in their late 20s and early 30s who are also doing puppet theater. UNIMA, the Union International de la Marionette, is an international organization with its headquarters in France. It started in 1929 in Czechoslovakia. And India has a national chapter, which is called UNIMA Puppeteers Trust. And in UNIMA, we've started training programs for puppeteers, traditional and contemporary puppeteers, with teachers who are both from traditional backgrounds and also European teachers and masters. And in 2019, early 20, we finished our first foundation program. This is the first ever full-time puppetry training program that India has ever had. Training has always been master to apprentice. So this is for us a huge achievement. We are continuing to build these kind of pedagogic programs, training programs, to train professional puppeteers. So I'm going to end the talk here, and I can already see there are a lot of questions. So I'm going to start. If Renuka, you want to...
Yeah. Honestly, thank you so much, Anurupa. It's been, I think you've really walked us through the quiet power of puppet theater in India today, and we all looking at the videos, we really feel like we have a show to catch, and we've not yet had the full glimpse of it. There are some questions. If you'd like to read them, you could too, but if that's easier for you, I could just read them out. Prasanna Mangrulkar asks, could you also tell us about the puppets of Vishnudas Bhave?
I'm sorry, Prasanna ji, I'm not aware of the puppets of Vishnudas Bhavre. Maybe you can tell me a little bit, because because there are many puppeteers who, especially modern puppeteers, and this is very unfortunate, we actually started to write a collection in the Sutradhar magazine, which is the UNIMA India's journal. We started to write feature articles, and of course there's a lot of stuff about traditional puppetry. And very unfortunately, there's nothing about the early traditional puppetry right up to the 80s. We have such limited information because they performed, they created work, and they died, leaving nothing behind. We traced a few, we know of the more famous ones, or the ones who had companies, and you know, the ones who left an archive behind. So if there's any puppeteer who you particularly found, please do let me know, and I can ask around. But there are, I have to confess, many puppeteers who I know nothing about, really know nothing about. So I'm sorry, I don't know an answer to your question, very unfortunately. There's Megan.
Yes, there's a question from Megan. She's asked two questions, actually. What kind of roles did puppetry play in the development of early childhood education, traditional or contemporary?
And she's asked me about my Pulcinella.
Yes.
Early childhood development is something that is a very recent discourse in puppet theater, even across the world. It's probably a 30-40-year-old discourse where the arts and education, especially for early childhood, has become a common discourse. Of course, you have systems or training systems where the arts were included, but this conscious effort to include puppet theater, for example, you have the Small Size Network in Europe now, which is very consciously looking at early childhood and puppet theater. In India, I must say this is very important because puppet theater in India was never for children. Traditional puppetry anywhere in the world was never really for children. Children also came to a puppet show. Whereas what happens in the 20th century is we have these separations. This is dance, this is music, this is actors theater, this is mass theater. Traditionally, no performance was a kind of performance. The performer had many, many, many skills. And the way to hold attention was to use all your skills. A dancer was essentially also a musician. A musician essentially understood dance and theater. Theater had to have rhythm. And so there was a lot of this cross current. I think the separations and this kind of understanding of theater is a postmodern phenomenon in India. It's a post-colonial phenomenon where you have this distinction of I'm going to go out and seek theater, not in my traditional community, but in a community where I've gone off to work. So it's a post-migration, post-industrial revolution kind of phenomena where the separation happened. And I think that's where people began to be very mindful of looking at education and puppet theater, children and puppetry. This has a certain politics to it as well, because there were certain states which were funding puppet theater and not allowing another kind of theater. So human theater, for example, was really censored and not allowed to be performed in its entirety because there was a worry about what the actor would say. But puppet theater was allowed because it was seen as frivolous, non-threatening. You know, you have fluffy dolls saying things. And there is a whole study now on the use of puppetry to be extremely political. Similarly, in childhood education, child psychology, the use of puppetry, especially also in developmental work, conflict resolution work, is a recent phenomenon. There's a lot of work being done. In Katkatha, we did a project with Barbara Colling from Helios Theater in Germany. Barbara, for now almost 30 years, has been working with toddlers and toddlers theater. She did a mentorship with 8 Indian companies, and 8 performances were created particularly for toddlers and the very, very young, very mindfully for that age group, you know. And I know Astrid India, for example, is doing a lot of discourse and some amount of workshops around very small children's theater. But puppets and material is something we've started looking at as of the last 7 years or so. Now we have performances which are for toddlers. But I think in India, this movement is quite limited yet. It's not a very big movement. As far as Pulcinella goes, I made him in 2002. He was my final puppet for my puppet exam in Napoli, in Naples, where I learned glove puppetry from Bruno Leoni, who's a fantastic master of this form. I hardly play with this puppet. I think glove puppets are the hardest. They're harder than string puppets. They look easy, but they're extremely difficult because your fingers really need to be, you know, everything needs to move and move very minimally. You have to really train to move different parts of your arm and your hand and your fingers and do very small, little movements. And Pulcinella is from the Commedia dell'arte. He's a traditional Italian comic character. He doesn't say horrible things. Burps and farts and does, you know, extremely terrible things. So I think I've embarrassed him, so I'm going to put him away.
I think we have one more question, and that I think you can take it, or Pulchanella can take it as well. Is there a form of traditional puppetry which uses ventriloquism completely in India, where the puppeteer alone takes on multiple voices? Vikram Sridhar is asking this.
Hi, Vikram. Well, no, there's no traditional ventriloquism in India. However, there are multiple voices, but it's not ventriloquism. So ventriloquism is essentially the art of voice projection, where you don't move your mouth. So there's an illusion created that the dummy is moving the mouth. In fact, ventriloquism doesn't always need a puppet. It's not an essential aspect. But ventriloquism in India is a very modern phenomena. However, like I was saying, this thing, multiple voices, is inherent in traditional puppetry, because the chorus or the choir or the storyteller is always supporting the storyteller. The storyteller is one or two people. If you look at Indonesia, for example, you have the dalang who does all voices. There are 100 choir of brothers, he does 100 voices. If you look at Tamil Nadu, L. Rajappam, master puppeteer, who very unfortunately passed away without the whole world watching what he did. He used to do, I have been very fortunate to watch one of his shows where he does 30 or 40 voices. You know, so he's behind the stage and changing characters and puppets. And he does all the voices. He does 20 demons. He does, you know, he does Ram, Sita, Lakshman. He does Hanuman, Marich, he does everything. And they are distinct characters and they're distinct voices. So I think voice play is very crucial to puppet theater, but not necessarily ventriloquism.
Okay. Thank you, Vikram. I hope that answers your question. Thank you, Anurupa. But before we let you go, because you've given us this emotional joyride that is the puppet theatre experience, could you let us know a little bit about how we can support puppet theatre? Like you recommended that we visit Pingali's Kala Angan. What could we do locally? Any word of advice for all of us to support this art?
I would say one of the things is I always find that the information people have on puppetry is very limited. I would really advise getting on to unimapuppeteerstrust.in or searching for the Sutradhar journals, where you can read up about all the questions that you've asked, because there are very good articles about early development, childhood development and puppetry, traditional master puppeteers, their interviews. So one of the things I would encourage everyone to do is really get informed, because then you know where to look for puppet theatre. Two is, if you're from a particular state, I would really say make the effort and go and find your local puppeteers and watch a performance, because it's the most incredible thing you will ever experience. These are sometimes something people have been doing for 11, 13, 15 generations. And it's only in India and the rest of South Asia where we still have, and some parts of Africa and very small parts of South America where we still have this. The rest of the world has lost this kind of continuous culture.
Thank you so much, Arupa. I think that's going to be informational for all of us going ahead, so we're able to apply this talk as well and really do something for the arts. Thank you so much. Thank you. And thank you all the audiences for being with us today. This talk will also be up on YouTube later in case you miss bits of it. You can watch it again, educate yourself more. And of course, let's support puppet theatre some more. Anurupa, thank you so much. There's a quiet applause going amongst all our audiences right now. Thank you.
Thank you
for being with us.
Bye-bye. See you all.
Bye. Thank you so much.